Hi, I'm Mark Miodownik. I'm the author of Stuff Matters, and I thought I'd read you a bit from the introduction. As I stood on a train, bleeding from what would later be classified as a 13-centimetre stab wound, I wondered what to do. It was May 1985, and I had just jumped onto a London tube train as the door closed, shutting out my attacker, but not before he had slashed my back. The wound stung like a very bad paper cut, and I had no idea how serious it was. But being a British schoolboy at the time, embarrassment overcame any kind of common sense. So instead of getting help, I decided the best thing to do would be to sit down, go home. And so, bizarrely, that is what I did. My assailant had approached me on the platform asking for money. When I shook my head, he got uncomfortably close, looked at me intently, and told me he had a knife. I followed his gaze down to the pocket of his blue anorak into which his hand was stuffed. I had a gut feeling that it was just his index finger that was creating the pointed bulge. Then another thought crept into my mind. Even if he did have a knife, it must be so small as to fit into the pocket that there was no way it could do me much damage. I own penknives myself, and I knew that such a knife would find it very hard to pierce the several layers I was wearing. A plan formed quickly in my mind. Keep him talking and then just push past him onto the train as the doors were closing. I could see the train arriving and was sure he wouldn't have time to react. It turned into a very personal book about my relationship with materials and why I am the person I am. When you try and deconstruct why you ended up doing what you did, and you know, you write a narrative for your life, and there are pivotal moments in them, and I got stabbed, and it changed my life. If you almost die, and you almost die because of your own stupidity, it sticks in your head. But then it's true that, you know, when you think about what a knife is, how amazingly sharp it is, and what is sharpness? How do you get something that sharp, that hard, and that strong in such a tiny sliver of metal? It actually encapsulates everything about materials that is interesting. You know, it's part of our culture. Everybody uses a knife every day. If you don't have knives in your kitchen, you don't really have a kitchen. You can't cook. The world is a dangerous place, and a lot of that danger comes from materials. It's also a brilliant, wonderful place, and a lot of that comes from materials. I wanted to get across the fact that each material has a different character, and I don't mean this in a kind of glib way. I mean it really, truly. And people have a very different feeling, and plastics behave very differently than ceramics, which behave very different from metals. Because, I mean, the thesis of the book is that the material world around us is an expression of who we are. It's a technical expression, but it's also an emotional and cultural expression. So the chapter on glass is called Invisible. Not because glass is invisible, but actually the truth is that it's a desire for invisibility of a material barrier that you can see through, but also doesn't occlude you in any way, doesn't trap you in any way. I wrote the chapter on paper, and I was thinking again how to get across paperness across, and it struck me that paper is so diverse in our lives that no one really leaves the house without paper in their pocket, in their wallet as money, or you know, under their arm as a newspaper or as a book. So I was talking to people like, what is the most important bits of paper in your life? I talked to my dad about this and realized that my dad had these old relics of him escaping from Germany, you know, when the Nazis were coming to power, and he had the actual documents. I had never seen them before. I needed, at the beginning of every chapter, to return to this sense of it's everything. What I'm talking about is everything, but let me just draw your attention to this material. And mostly you ignore it, and good, because you're not obsessive like me. But let me just, for a few days of your life or a few weeks of your life, just get you into what that material is, whether it's a ceramic or whether it's a brick or whether it's a plastic or whether it's a piece of cloth or a piece of paper. I mean, because every single material has such a, you know, thousands of years of science embedded in it, you know, what can you really hope that someone takes away from the book? And one thing that science does very well is it systematizes knowledge. And so the question is, what is the system to understand a particular subject? Well, in chemistry, it's the molecule. Like, if you understand that there are atoms and they have bonds together, and they can bond to other things, then you can understand chemistry. That's essentially the central principle. So what is it for material science? Well, it turns out that the world is full of structures that are all built inside each other, like a Russian doll. And if you understand those structures, what they are, so you need microscopes, then you understand why something is sticky and why something is strong or why something is blue or why something is squidgy. That's it. I am genuinely absolutely elated to be nominated for this prize. It's really fantastic. I learned such a lot writing the book, learning how to write, and to be kind of with some of these people who've been nominated who are professional science writers who do it for a living. I feel like, you know, a fan, you know, a football fan who's invited onto the pitch and is allowed to play a game with the professionals, and that's great.